Now there is no record. You assume the best of me. And this is why I thank the Lord for saving me when I was weak. So I will sing. This is why I thank the Lord for everything. This is why I thank the Lord. And this is why I thank the Lord for saving me when I was weak. So I will sing. This is why I thank the Lord for everything. This is why I thank the Lord. All of my affection, everything I have to give, some of my attention is measured in the praise I live. So this is how I thank the Lord for saving me when I was weak. So I will sing. This is how I thank the Lord for everything. This is how I thank the Lord. Oh, this is how I thank the Lord for loving me and keeping me. So I will sing. This is how I thank the Lord for everything. This is how I thank the Lord. I will sing, I will sing, I will lift my praises to you. I will sing,
I will sing,
I will sing, I will sing my praises to you. I will sing,
I will sing,
I will sing,
I will sing,
I will lift my praises to you. I will sing, I will sing, 'cause this is how I praise the Lord. This is how I thank the Lord for saving me when I was weak. So I will sing. This is how I thank the Lord for everything. This is how I thank the Lord.
This is how I thank the Lord.
This is how.
This is how I thank the Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. How is everybody? You doing good? Beautiful day. I think I'm going to speak over here because I worry about this section up here. Actually, you have scared me. I'm going to go back over here. Hey, welcome to Live 58 Church. Glad you're here today. And can we, like we do each week, welcome those that are watching us online? And if you're new here for the first time, you are so welcome to be here. Thank you so much. I want to do just a couple celebrations. We're going to be doing this order of service more often because we want it just to kind of flow from music to the message. So we're going to do our tithes and our offerings right now. And for those of us who call Live 58 our church home, we give. And so thank you for your generosity in giving. The ushers are going to come forward. Thank you. Whether you give online or you give here, thank you so much for that. Let me tell you what we're going to do for the next couple weeks. We're coming off a week of Easter, and I've done a lot of, yes, Easter. I've done a lot of Easter messages, and what the hardest part about Easter is when it's over, you go, well, it's over, wait till next year. And I'm not doing that this year. We are going to do Easter today, and we're going to do Easter next Sunday. So this is, oh, cool, thank you. Well, wait till you hear the message. But there's so many rich stories that happen after the resurrection that we're going to stay there, because in one way or another, there should be a little bit of the Easter message every week, 52 weeks out of the year, because it changes everything. Today's message is on hope. We're going to end with communion. And so for those watching online, if you're home, you may want to grab something so that you can take communion with us at the end of the service. Just a couple of reminders, too, about our partnerships, our food bank. We have one more week of cereal. Thanks for all the cereal you brought for the food bank. We have men's and women's Bible studies that are continuing on now that Easter's over. Wednesday nights, it's a great way to connect and grow in your faith. Tuesday mornings, men do breakfast at Bella Brew, and it's a great way to get to know one another there also. Also in 2 weeks, I'll give a little more information next week, but in 2 weeks, we have a very special service, a special interview that will warm your hearts, challenge your hearts, and it's with one of our partnerships, and so that's in 2 weeks. So Rob lost his voice today, so I'm going to lead worship and preach, so... Arise and shine and give God the glory. Arise and shine. Just kidding, Rob can sing. Why don't you stand up and say hi to one another? Greet your neighbor, and then we'll start.
Well, you can remain standing. Why don't you stand? Great to see you here today. What an awesome day. This is the day the Lord's made. Let's rejoice and be glad in it. I'm just going to open with a scripture as we go into worship. From Romans 15, 13, it says, "May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit you may abound in hope." He is our hope today. Amen. Amen. Let's worship together. Let's sing this together.
As I count on one thing, the same God that never fails will not fail me now. He won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God that's never late is working all things out. He's working all things out. Oh, yes, I will lift you up in the lowest valley. Won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God that's never late is working all things out. He's working all things out. Oh, yeah. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. And great are you, Lord. Let's sing it out together. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. You give life, you are love, you bring life. Heart that is broken, so great. will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great.
Together.
And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will say, great are you, Lord. And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will. I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fail me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Amen. All my life you have been faithful, and all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In the darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness of God. Oh. The goodness of God. Oh, 'cause your goodness is running after, it's running after me. 'Cause your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything. 'Cause your goodness is running. Just running after, it's running. life you have been faithful.
Yes.
And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I'm gonna sing of the goodness of God.
Let's sing that out together.
Oh, it's all my
Lord, we stand in awe this morning of your faithfulness, for the fact that you meet us right where we're at, no matter what season that we're in. Lord, we can look back to your goodness in our lives, your faithfulness, for you know the plans you have for us, plans to prosper, not to harm, plans for a hope and a future. We thank you for that today. We thank you for the hope that we have in you. Lord, we give you honor and praise. In Jesus' name, and everyone said, amen. Amen. You can be seated.
Yesterday, the darkness was thick, the air unbreathable. Yesterday, we were defeated. Lost, without hope. But that was yesterday. And now a new day begins. The night is over. The sun is rising. And darkness is on the run. Because this is the day that changes everything. This is the day we dare to hope. This is the day we are brave enough to believe. This is the day we face down every fear and brazenly look in the empty tomb. This is the day sight is restored. The day that life takes its first breath. The day that thorns are replaced with a crown. This is the day that death is reversed. Light overcomes darkness. Wonder defies sorrow. Today we look to the heavens, alive with hope, and boldly proclaim, this is the day the Lord has made.
You're dismissed. You know, Peter is at the end of his life. He's older, and he's seen it all. He's done it all. He walked with Christ for 3 years, betrayed Christ, doubted, and then was restored after the resurrection. Then he's led the church. He's preached boldly. His life has changed, and he's towards the end of his life, and he realizes what the resurrection means, and this is what he writes. This is our key scripture today. You're going to hear me read it at least 5 or 6 times, and you might read it with me. Peter wrote, "In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." I'll read it again. "In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." You know, I'm not sure who said it but I've said it several times here. Someone once said, humans can live 40 days without food, 4 days without water, 4 minutes without air, but we cannot live 4 seconds without hope. Humans seek after hope like moths seek after light. It's intrinsic to who we are. Studies show hopeful college students get higher grades and are more likely to graduate. Hopeful athletes perform better on the field and recover quickly from injury. In the elderly, those who have hope live longer than those who feel hopeless. Dr. Shane Lopez, who's regarded as this world's leading researcher on hope, claims that hope isn't just an emotion. It's an essential to life, hope. So Peter, late in his life, says, in his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. But the psalmist says, why so downcast, O my soul? Why so downcast? Well, because when you look around our world, many times we can feel hopeless. With broken governments, wars, famines, disease, chaos, it can feel hopeless. Add that to our own personal lives, a failing relationship, a wayward child, a chronic illness, a strangling addiction, an overwhelming loss, and you can say, well, there's this living hope, but many times I don't feel hopeless. I don't feel hope. Would you agree with me this morning that life can be tough and hopelessness can creep in? Has hopelessness ever creeped in to your life? It has mine. When pain and disappointment come by the truckload, life can feel hopeless. My friend, just in the last 4 months, has lost his dear brother, his closest brother, and his mother in just 4 months. Life can smack us upside the face. But today, Easter part two, I want to share how the living hope of the resurrection changes everything. In the midst of storms, in the midst of pain, in the midst of even chaos, there is a living hope that cannot be taken away. I want to tell you a story, an Easter story. It's probably my favorite story. It's a story of lost hope and then a story of found hope. It's a story of learning to put your hope in the right thing. Now, we've been in this series where we've been looking at characters around the cross and at the resurrection. I just want you to put yourself into these people's shoes, because I don't want to tell you how to hope today or why to hope. I want this story to teach us all what hope really looks like. Because in his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. So let's jump into the story. Let's just go through the story and we'll be done and do communion. On Friday morning, Jesus is nailed to a cross. By noon, he is dead. He's buried in a tomb with a stone rolled in front of it, and Roman guards are stationed there. But early Sunday morning, some women who were followers of Jesus went to the tomb and found it empty. And some angels appeared and said, "Why do you look for the living among the dead?" That's a whole sermon in itself. "He is not here, he has risen. Remember how he told you. Remember he told you while he was still with you in Galilee, the Son of Man must be delivered over to the hands of sinners, be crucified, and on the third day be raised again." I've got four thoughts about hope through this story, okay? Four. The first thought is this about hope. When we are in deep pain or despair, when we are losing hope, it's easy to forget. It's easy to forget. The psalmist cries out, "God is our refuge and strength and ever-present help in trouble," but it's easy to forget. "Lo, I am with you always," Jesus says, but it's easy to forget. "Nothing can separate us from his love," but it's easy to forget. "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits," but it's easy to forget when we are losing hope. I was talking to someone last Sunday in the lobby after Easter service, and he said, "During the week, I get busy, I get weary, I got challenges," and he says, and I quote, "I have made this Sunday service my weekly reminder of God's goodness and faithfulness because it's easy to forget." When it comes to hope, it's easy to forget. These ladies had heard the words of Jesus that he would die and raise from the dead, but they had forgotten. It's easy to forget when we're going through tough times. The story continues. "Now that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. And as they talked and discussed these things with each other, now, okay, get into the story now. As they're talking on this road to Emmaus, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. Picture that. Why didn't they recognize him? Was the sun in their eyes? Did Jesus get a new haircut after the resurrection? Was he wearing a nose and glasses disguise? No, verse 16 says they were kept. They were kept from recognizing him. A supernatural force was at work. God was at work. Let me say this again. God was at work. These two travelers were in the presence of Jesus, but they didn't recognize him. They didn't know. So here's my question. Since they didn't know it was Jesus, does it make it any less true that Jesus was with them? Class, you can answer that. No. Just because they didn't know Jesus was with them, it didn't make it that he wasn't. He was with them. Here's my second thought about hope. Many times God is at work in our lives, even when we can't see him, even when we don't know it. Our eyes maybe don't recognize it at the time and all the chaos when life seems to be on pause. You go, God, where are you? The truth is this, it doesn't stop the fact that God is there and God is at work. You know, men love their remote control. I love my remote control. Amen. Thank you. I love the pause button on my TV remote control. It gives me the illusion that I have control over time, right? Just press it. I can answer my phone. I can get more coffee. I can finish a conversation. Then I can press it again, and I'm right back where I left off. I am in control when I got my remote control. I have, however, found that I'm not a fan of the pause button in life. When life seems to be standing still and I'm not the one who pressed the pause button. My circumstances and my faith have ground to a halt like a locomotive pulling into the station. Hopelessness creeps in when we're at that pause and we're not in control of it. It's in those pause moments where I wonder, where is God? And that's where I tend to forget his promises. These two men are on the road. Their lives were on pause. Their hopes had been dashed. God seems a long ways away. I can relate. I think we can relate. We've been there. In our forgetfulness and hopelessness with our lives on pause, the Spirit speaks out straight into our pause, where he says, "He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty." This verse addresses dwelling in a secret place. It's a beautiful phrase, dwelling. I picture a quaint little cottage up in the woods and a cozy fire. But dwelling doesn't mean that. Let me tell you what that means. Dwelling. I learned this week. You learn something new every week. It's an engineering word, dwell. Dwell means a brief pause in the motion of a part of a mechanism to allow an operation to be completed. God dwells in my empty, silent pauses so he can create a space to complete me. The pause actually is necessary. This pause for these two men on the road is not punishment. It's not because they've been forgotten. It's because they need completed. God is at work. This dwelling is just a brief pause to allow an operation to be completed. I look back, and we can all look back at moments in our lives, but I look back in the moments of my life between 2017 and 2020, and my life was on pause. But it was a pause I can look back on now to see that God was doing a work in me. For 3 years, and especially 2017, I felt God was distant from me. But I look back now, and he was there all along, even when I couldn't see it. Because God needed to stop me and pause me, because I needed to spend time dwelling in the secret place, abiding under the shadow of the Almighty. Because God needed to do some work to complete me. He was healing me. He was growing me, aligning me with some like-minded people. God was at work. I just couldn't see it at the time. Gladys Aylward talks about when she was a child, she had two great sorrows. One that while all her friends had beautiful golden hair, hers was black. The other sorrow was that while her friends were still growing, she stopped at 5 feet tall. Gladys became a missionary, And as she stood on the wharf in Shanghai looking around at the people whom God had called her to, she says, every single one of them had black hair, and every one of them had stopped growing when I did. She was able to say God was at work, but her eyes didn't recognize it at the time. The first thought about hope, when we're in deep despair, when we're losing hope, it's easy to forget the promises of God. The second thought about hope, many times God is at work, and we don't even know it. These men don't know it's Jesus. Let's continue with the story. He asked them, what are you discussing together as you walk along? They stood there, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, are you only a visitor to Jerusalem and do not know the things that have happened there in these days? And Jesus is just playing along. Well, what things? What things happened? It would be like the day after 9/11, walking up to somebody and saying, hey, did anything significant happen yesterday? Jesus is messing with them, and so he says, well, what, tell me the things. And they said, it's about Jesus of Nazareth. He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. And the chief priests and the rulers handed him over to be sentenced, and they crucified him. But we had hoped. They crucified him, but we had hoped. Why were the two travelers so downcast? Maybe they wore the wrong walking shoes. Maybe there was no Starbucks along the way. Maybe they were chafing in the desert heat. No. Their hopes had been shattered. But they had hoped. They had hoped. Wow. You could write 1,000 stories around those words, couldn't you, friends? They had hoped. But we had hoped, they said. You see, here's the thing today. The question isn't, do you need hope? Or even, do you have hope? The question is, what are you putting your hope in? That's the question. Most of our hopes are fragile hopes. Maybe not bad hopes, just fragile, unsustaining. I hope I find that special person. That's not a bad hope. It might happen and it might not, but it won't bring ultimate fulfillment. I hope my kids or grandchildren grow up to be outstanding people. That is a beautiful hope, but as they get older, you realize there's no guarantees. I hope my medical report comes back clean. It's a good hope, but there's no guarantees. In this world, hopes are fragile. I hope the 49ers eventually win a Super Bowl again. That's a great hope, but there are 29 other teams trying to dash our hopes. Their hopes had been shattered. They're on the road, heading home, because they had put their hope not in a bad thing, but they'd put their hope in the wrong thing. Imagine this, they'd put their hope in a political hope. Yeah, that's probably not a really good hope to put yourself in. They were hoping that Jesus would overthrow the Roman government because nobody wants to be a slave, but God was at work doing a greater eternal work. But they had hope. They were just hoping for the wrong things. Let me read it again. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. And then Peter adds on, that can never perish, spoil, or fade. You see, all my other hopes, even the great hopes, can spoil or perish or fade. But the resurrection living hope that you and I live in can never perish, spoil, or fade. Isn't that beautiful? The resurrection living hope is not fragile. But we had hoped, they said, but we had hoped, and Jesus listens. It's a beautiful thing. Jesus just listens. And then, after Jesus listens, Jesus, it says, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. A Bible lesson from Jesus on Jesus. Now that's cool. I'd go to that class. He helps them to see their story wrapped up in God's story. He helps them understand the cross was necessary, that everything Jesus did in his life and in his suffering was done out of love to bring forgiveness and healing and hope to our sad, broken world. And I just stop right here. Isn't that what we're called to do as followers of Christ? To help others, to help our neighbor, to help someone, a friend, to see their story is wrapped up in God's story. To see that God so loved them that he gave his life, his son. To help others see their life through the lens of God's grace and mercy. This is what Jesus did with these two gentlemen. Cleopas and his friend are nearing their home, and Jesus is giving a Jesus lesson to them. And Jesus walks ahead as if he were going on. And they still don't know it's Jesus, but they urge him strongly, saying, stay with us, because it's almost evening and the day is now nearly over. So he went to stay with them. Another important part in this story, Jesus doesn't invite himself into the home. He waits for an invitation. Jesus joins us on the journey without asking. That's true, because he's faithful and he's there all along. But at some point, and maybe at a lot of points, he waits to be invited into our lives. I stand at the door and knock, he says. If you hear my voice and open the door, I will come in and eat with you, and you will eat with me. Jesus comes to the door of our hearts knocking, but he waits to be let in. He never forces his way in. But when he's invited, Jesus accepts the invitation. And then this is just a beautiful part of this story. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, he gave thanks, he broke it, and began to give it to them. And then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him. What allowed the two to finally recognize Jesus? What was it? Was it they handed out name tags? Oh, it's Jesus. I didn't know. No. Then their eyes were opened. Why? Third thought about hope. Third thought. God opens our eyes to his living hope when we break bread together and worship together the resurrected Christ. Friends, I believe this more now than I ever have. A simple meal they share together becomes holy. Jesus takes the bread, blesses it, breaks it, and gives it to them, and then their eyes are opened. They recognize him. For in the breaking of the bread together, they recognize him, and they begin to have hope. As Jesus said earlier, "For where two or three gather together as my followers, I am there among them." The church, the community of believers, is a place to find hope. This is a place to find hope. I pity followers of Jesus who try to live in this world in their faith outside the community of faith. I understand why, because sometimes you've been burnt by the church, or sometimes you go, well, there's too much dysfunction in the church, but don't throw the baby out with the dirty bathwater, because the church is a place where we find hope. In fact, I have learned something supernatural happens when we come together that can't happen to us individually. Great things can happen to us in our prayer closet and in our alone time, but there's something God does when we gather together like this. They broke bread together and they recognized Jesus. One of the lines I hear from time to time, people saying, "I couldn't have made it through whatever they were going through without the love, care, and support of my church." That's why Hebrews says this, not in a legalistic way, but in a freedom kind of way, in a hope-filled kind of way. "And let us not give up meeting together. Some are in the habit of doing this. Instead," and I love this, "let us encourage one another with words of hope." When our leadership team prays in the circle at 9:30 before the 10 o'clock, that's the number one prayer, that you may come in here and experience in the living hope of Christ, and you can leave here with that hope that does not perish, that does not fade. In breaking bread together, God says, "Bear one another's burdens. Encourage one another and build one another up, just as you are doing." God opens our eyes to the living hope when we break bread together, which we are going to do at the end of this service. When we worship together the resurrected Christ, something supernatural happens. You see, I've been in ministry long enough to see eyes opened up when we break bread together. I've seen it over and over. It's not just a theory or something I've read in a book. I've seen it over and over. God opens people's eyes to the power and hope to overcome addictions, to see that there is still life and healing after a devastating loss. I've seen people's eyes opened up to the healing power of grace for those who've been beaten up by religion. And I have seen God open up people's eyes to the power of forgiveness that takes away paralyzing shame and guilt. Vince, you can say amen to that. Amen. Good. I was just checking if you're awake. They recognize Jesus, and so then they ask each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us?" I love that line. Sometimes we can't see Jesus, we're always there, but we look back and we go, yeah, he was there all along. God was there all along, and I'm glad that they may have been thinking, "I'm so glad." They finally see it's Jesus, and they're like, "Man, I'm glad we welcomed a stranger into our home. That worked out pretty good." Hebrews says it, "Do not forget to be kind to strangers. Some people have had angels in their homes without knowing it." These guys had more than angels. They had Jesus. So they got up. It's the end of the story. I love this. They got up, and returned at once to Jerusalem because they had newfound hope. They found the 11 and those with them assembled together, and they say, it's true. It's true. The Lord has risen. Don't miss this. This is powerful. They got on the same road, the road they were discouraged on, and now they're on that same road, but now they're not discouraged anymore. A road that had been marked by defeat, hopelessness, the same road that was marked with shattered dreams. Now the road is different. It's the same road, but everything looks different. The resurrection has changed everything. Because they encountered the resurrected Christ, the road was full of possibilities. Hope was alive. Same road, different conversations going back. Same road, different observations, different realizations. Here's my last thought on hope today. Fourth thought on hope. God longs for you and I to get back on the road of hope through the power of the resurrected Christ. For in his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead that can never perish, spoil, or fade. So we must preach Easter all the time here. Because this is what it's all about. The resurrection changes everything, friends. Everything. It is a living hope. There were some buddies discussing death, and one of the guys asked his friends, well, what would you like people to say about you at your funeral? And one guy says, well, that I cared about my community. Another guy says, well, I hope they say he was a great husband and father. And then they look to the third guy. He goes, well, I hope they say, look, he's moving. Friends, Jesus was moving. He was alive, and he still is. He still is alive, and he's still doing resurrections in people's lives. He's resurrecting our souls. He's turning sadness into gladness. He's turning fear into courage. See, this is our ultimate hope. It's the resurrection that gives us the living hope. Again, I look at my life. For 3 years, somehow I kind of forgot. I kind of forgot all the faithfulness of God. Maybe I was in denial, whatever, but it's easy to forget. First thought, it's easy to forget. Second thought, many times God is at work and we don't even know it. And boy, is that the truth. Sometimes he puts us on pause to dwell because he has a work that he needs to complete. If I would have just kept going the pace I was going in 2017, if God didn't pause my life, he could have never worked on me. Third thought, God opens our eyes to his hope when we break bread together and worship together the resurrected Christ. Friends, I believe this. We're not trying to be a church just to say, look at all the people that come, or hey, we did our weekly duty. No, where two or three are gathered together as my followers, I am there among them. And my goal in life is I want to stand before God one day and just, well done, good and faithful servant, you offered and you shared with people the resurrected hope. Fourth thought, God longs for us to get back on the road of hope through the power of the resurrected Christ. I don't know what that means for you today, but maybe it's time for you to get back on the road. In 2020, I got back on that road because God had done some work in me, put me together in some fellowship with two or three amazing people and leaders, and we started this church. It's amazing, this story, The Road to Emmaus, how it fits all of our lives in different seasons of our lives. So friends, let's live with the living hope as we celebrate. Never forget the power of the resurrection. You know, I shared it earlier. The psalmist says, why so downcast, O my soul? Oh, then it says, put your hope in God. Put your hope in God. So I want to read Peter's line again, but I want us to all read it together before Rob sings and we hand out communion. Just read it out loud with me, and I've added the next line that Peter writes. So let's read it together. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead that can never perish, spoil, or fade. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you. Amen. 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 We're going to hand out communion. Just hold on to it, and when we're done with the song, We'll do it together.
Man, I'd like to
pray for you, but before that, let's take these elements and just be reminded. I'm just going to let you take them quietly. I won't even go through the procedure. Let's just take a few moments and pray and think about these thoughts of hope that it's easy to forget, and that's why we come together to be reminded. I just want to remind you that God is at work. God is at work in your life. And there is something powerful as we gather like this, where two or three are gathered. And maybe for some watching or here, you're saying it's time to get back up on the road. Maybe there's been a pause in your life, but you've realized that that was just God at work. Okay, I'm going to be quiet now because I talk too much. But just take this when you want to take it. This is his bread, the bread that represents his broken body. This is the cup that represents his shed blood. We stand. I love that part of the story. When he broke the bread, they recognized him. Something very powerful when we do this together. Thanks for being here today. You know, every morning when I go out to my lime tree to now the pray the Lord's Prayer, Thursday was really cold out there, by the way. But we serve a risen Savior who has an eternal kingdom, and that's a pretty cool thing. Just don't forget that as we leave there today. And may we, in a compassionate way, we pray, God, would you put somebody in my path where I can tell them your story and that they're part of your story. So let's conclude with the Lord's Prayer. It won't be on the screen. We'll just say it out loud, and it's always interesting. Some say trespass. Some say debt. Some say, yeah. That's all right. Do what you want to do, all right? Let's do it together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever and ever and ever and ever. Amen. God bless you guys. We'll see you next week for part 3 of Easter.